Today we are going to discuss the support vector machine, which is one of the most prominent algorithms in traditional machine learning. We are going to start with what the intuition is, and then we are going to derive the primal problem for the support vector machine in today's lecture. Maybe as a prelude, the support vector machine has been discovered in the 1990s, at least the most important components come from that time. And the support vector machine is the algorithm that made machine learning its own subdiscipline in computer science. Because support vector machines were so successful that all of a sudden people had a simple algorithm with only very few parameters to tune that could solve rather complicated problems. And it has a very powerful mechanism which is called the kernel trick, which makes or which can turn an algorithm that is linear in the first place, like a support vector machine, into some very powerful nonlinear machine. We're going to see all this in the next couple of lectures, and today we are going to start with the linear case of the hard margin support vector machine. Let us start again with the intuition. So as in the algorithms we've seen before, we are in the situation of linear classification. So we're given some points in RD, and we want to classify them into a number of classes. We are going to use linear classification. So again, we are going to classify by hyperplanes in the same way as it was the case for logistic regression or also for linear discriminant analysis. And again, if you look at the slide, we have the question, there might be many different hyperplanes that realize a particular classification of our data set. Now, which hyperplane are we supposed to choose? And we have already seen two different answers to this question. We have seen the geometric answer by linear discriminant analysis, where we said, you know, we need to project such that the classes, the points within the class are projected tightly together and the distance between the classes gets very large. This was a geometric motivation. And now we want to see another geometric motivation, the one that leads to support vector machines in the end. The main idea of support vector machines from a geometric point of view is what is called the margin. So consider the slide. And assume we have a data set that is very nicely separable by a hyperplane. So there exists a hyperplane that can perfectly separate all these data points from each other, the points from the two classes. Now, if there's one hyperplane, there are often many hyperplanes that can separate the data. And now, which one are we supposed to take? What we do is we consider the margin. And the margin, as you can see it here in the plot, if you have a hyperplane, you sort of draw the margin, you go in parallel to your hyperplane, outside from your hyperplane, as far as you can go before you touch a point. You can see that on the slides. So the hyperplane is somewhere, and then sort of the margin is where if you go to the outside, where you start touching the points from the two classes. And the idea is, we would like to find a hyperplane that has a large such margin. And the question is, why would this make sense? I would maybe like to go back to this example we had on the previous slide. If you consider the three hyperplanes here, you might want to say H1, sure, it classifies all points correctly, but it is very close to the red class. I don't know whether you will be able to see this in the video, but here at this particular point on the right top of the plot, the hyperplane is close to touching this red point. And if you now imagine, if you add a bit of wiggling to this red point, for example, some measurement noise, then it immediately might jump to the other side of the hyperplane and might get a different label. So in this sense, if we would choose the hyperplane H1, it doesn't seem like a pretty robust choice. If we add a little noise to our data, the classification of some points might change. The same is true for the hyperplane H3. So here, this is close to this other data point here from the other class. And hyperplane H2 is at least a bit better because its distance from the two classes is a bit larger. So if you only add a tiny amount of noise to your training points, the classification of these training points is not going to change. So this is one of the reasons why we would think that having a large margin might be a very good idea. It adds some robustness to our classifier. So one of the reasons why we might want to have a large margin is robustness. Because if we add a bit of noise to our data, the classification of the data points might not change as easily. What we are going to see later on is that the size of the margin also induces some kind of regularization. And the larger the margin, the higher we regularize. And if we manage to find classifications, or if we find functions that realize a separation with a large margin, this means that we have found a very simple function from a small function class. But this is going to come later. Let's get a bit more formal. What we want to do is, we want to do classification by a hyperplane. So what we're interested in, a linear classifier of the form that we have seen before, a function that is the sine of omega x plus b, where omega and b are the two parameters that we want to learn. For the SVMs, if we want to solve an optimization problem, there's an important thing that we need to figure out right now. Namely, if we multiply the parameters w and b by the same constant a, then of course the hyperplane is not going to change. Because if you look at what happens to the sine of this function, it is still the same. So if you look at here, the sine, like here I multiplied a times w and a times b, and then I take the sine. And of course you can take a out because it's a linear function, and then the sine, if a is a positive constant, the sine doesn't have any influence on the sine of this function. But this is a degree of freedom that one often wants to get rid of in optimization problems, because often this degree of freedom sort of hinders you to find a good solution for your optimization problem, or it's one degree freedom that you don't like to have. So what you typically do in such a situation, you fix some constant that you want to take. And the way we fix it in this particular case is we define what is a hyperplane in canonical representation, or in canonical form. And here's the definition. We say that the pair WB is in canonical form with respect to the given data points that you have. If the following is true, you evaluate the absolute value of of the hyperplanes on your training points. So WXI plus B is the value that this hyperplane function takes on all your training points. Now we're only interested in the absolute value, and we want that the minimum of these absolute values is 1. And this fixes implicitly the constants, because if we would now multiply this by a constant, then the minimum would not be 1 anymore. So we choose essentially the constants by which we could multiply in omega and b by fixing it such that this equation is true. And if this equation is true, then we say we have a hyperplane in a canonical representation. This is some kind of ad hoc notation. It's only used in support vector machine. This is nothing that you would see somewhere else in mathematics or so. So this is just used a term for which is helpful for support vector machines. Now let's try to formally define the margin. So again, we say H is any hyperplane. And for now, we assume that we have a training set, and that this hyperplane perfectly separates this training set. So we start by introducing support vector machines in the perfectly realizable case. And now we want to define what the margin is. And we say the margin of the hyperplane H with respect to the given training points is defined as the minimal distance of the training points to the hyperplane. So for each training point, you compute what is the distance of this training point to the hyperplane, and then you take the minimal distance, and this is then what we call the margin. And recall, this sort of corresponds to our intuition. The margin somehow measures by how far I can move the hyperplane before I start to touch the training points, and this is exactly the distance the training points have from the hyperplane. So the formal definition, rho, the margin is in the support vector machine literature is always called rho, rho of the hyperplane with respect to the training points x1 to xn is defined as the minimum distance of the training points xi to the hyperplane. And now if you look at what is the distance of a point to a hyperplane, the distance of a point of point xi to the hyperplane is just you check for all points on the hyperplane which one is the one that is closest to the training point xi, and then you take the minimum over all of those, and this is the distance of a point to a hyperplane. Okay, and in the image again, if you look at it, we have the two classes, we have the hyperplane, and the margin is the distance of the hyperplane to the closest training point. Now the first proposition we want to make is how to compute the margin, given we have the hyperplane and we have the training points. And the proposition now says, For a hyperplane in canonical representation, the margin rho can be computed as rho is 1 over the Euclidean norm of W. So we are still in the Euclidean space because we do linear classification in the space RD. We look at the Euclidean norm in the space, and the norm of W, the inverse norm of W, is what is the margin. And there are many different ways in which you can prove that, and they're all very simple, but I want to show you one of them. It goes as follows. So assume we have a point on the hyperplane. So x is a point that sits on the hyperplane. Then obviously it has to satisfy the hyperplane equation, which is wx plus b is 0. Okay, so this is just by the definition of the hyperplane. Now if we have a point that sits on the margin, we know that this point satisfies omega x plus b is either plus 1 or minus 1. And this comes from the definition of the canonical representation and from the definition of the margin. And now we consider x being the training point that is closest to the hyperplane. So there might be many training points, but we look at the one that is closest to the hyperplane. And without loss of generality, we now assume that it takes the value plus 1. So it could be minus 1 or plus 1. The argument goes exactly the same way, you just have to change the sign. So without loss of generality, we use plus 1 here. And now let h be that point on the hyperplane which is closest to this point x. So we now have x as this point that is closest to the hyperplane. So here we have x, here we have the hyperplane, and here we have this point lowercase h, which is the point that is closest on the hyperplane, which is closest to x. And now by all the things we have defined above, it's easy to see that the distance of x to h is rho by the definition of the margin. And here's a figure maybe to illustrate it. So here we have in the middle we have the hyperplane, which satisfies omega x plus b is 0. Here we have this point that is the red point here, which is closest to the hyperplane, and it satisfies omega x plus b is 1. Points on this other side would satisfy omega x plus b is minus 1. And we're interested in this distance here. This is the margin, which is rho. Now, what we also know is that x, the point x, can be written as h plus rho times omega over norm omega. And now maybe I go back to this figure here. The point x is this one here. And in vector notation, how can I get from the origin to this point x? I start in the origin, I first move to h, and then I need to move along this red line here. And what is this red line? The direction of this line is omega, that's the normal vector of the hyperplane. And if I want to know how long I need to walk along this line, I need to take the length of this line times omega. Now, but now omega might not have norm 1, so I first need to normalize. So if you want to know how long to walk along a certain vector, you need to walk, you need to have a unit vector and then multiply it by the length you want to walk. So here we go from the origin to the point h on the hyperplane, and then for the length of rho, we walk along this normal vector w, normalized to 1 such that this equation is true. And now essentially we just need to do simple manipulations. Now what we do is, this is the equation we start with. Now we take the left side and the right side of this equation and build the scalar product with w. So here we have now wx is, and w the right side of the equation. So we just took the two parts of the equation and put them into a scalar product jointly with w. And now here I can also take out this linear, so it's again a linear form here, so I can pull it into the two parts. And in the next line I can also add b on both sides. If I have an equation, I can add b and nothing changes. And now you can observe, on the left side we have now omega x plus b, which we know by definition is 1, because this is the way we chose the point. It sits on the margin, so it has to have 1 here, because we have canonical form. And here we have omega h plus b, which is 0 by definition, because h sits on the hyperplane. And then here's the remaining term. So what we're left with is 1 equals rho times norm of w. And now if you want to solve for rho, you get rho is 1 over norm of w. And that's it. That's the part of the proof, the easiest proof for the margin. I go back once more. So what we have proved now is that if our hyperplane has canonical representation, then the margin can be computed as 1 over norm of W. The slides also have an alternative proof. You can read it if you like. Now we already have all the ingredients to define what is the hard margin SVM. So what we want to do is, given training points, and under the assumption that they are separable by hyperplanes, we want to find a hyperplane that separates, that is, has a large margin as large as possible. So we have an objective function that says maximize the margin, so among all the hyperplanes, maximize the margin. Subject to, under the constraints, that all points are on the correct side of the margin. That all points are on the correct side of the hyperplane and outside the margin. And this sounds a bit funny, so maybe let's look at it in formulas. So the first one is easy. We want to maximize the margin, so we want to maximize rho. So we want to find a hyperplane, so the parameters W and B, such that rho is as large as possible, which is equivalent to saying 1 over norm of W should be as large as possible, because rho is 1 over norm of W. And now the conditions, that's a bit tricky to see on the, in the first place. What we want is that yi, so xi yi is a training point. We want that the training point yi equals the sign that the support vector machine gives to that input point. So we put the input point xi into our hyperplane equation, look at the sign, and ideally the sign should be the same as the one that's given in our training data, yi. This is what we want to have. And then we also want to have that in absolute value that omega xi plus b is larger or equal to 1, because we want to have that point sitting outside of the hyperplane. And these conditions we want for all training points I from 1 to n. And typically there is a way to simplify these two things, or to change the optimization problem. Maybe I go back once more. So instead of maximizing 1 over norm of W, which is sort of an inconvenient function for optimization, we could also say we want to minimize the norm of W. So if you take the inverse of an expression, we go from maximizing to minimizing, and it's exactly the same kind of problem. Just minimizing a norm is something that's much, much easier conceptually than maximizing 1 over the norm. That's the one change we do. And now the other change we do is we want to sort of write these cumbersome conditions here in a somewhat more elegant way. And let's see it on the next slide. So we can subsume both these conditions in one form by saying we want that the product of yi, the true label, times this expression here, which is essentially the predicted label, should be larger than 1. So let's digest this. The blue expression here is what the hyperplane spits out for your training point xi, and the sign of this expression should be the same as yi. So first of all, if you would request that yi times this blue expression is greater or equal to 0, no, greater than 0, then we would already request that the predicted sign is the correct one, because if yi is plus 1 and the predicted sign is plus 1, we have a positive thing here, the same if both are negative. This is sort of in a similar spirit as what we have seen when we looked at the plots for the loss function. So yi times f of x, if this is positive, then we have predicted the correct thing. Looking at it from this point of view, we would say we should have greater than 0 here. But now we have this other condition. If we go back to the previous slide, we have the second condition, which in fact says it should be larger or equal to 1. And this is now a simple way on the next slide to satisfy this as well. And the problem, as it's written here, is called the primal hard margin support vector machine. Maybe one more comment. I added this factor 1/2 here in front of W's norm of W. This factor 1/2 doesn't really change a lot. It's just for mathematical convenience. And something else that changed is we added a square here. And this is also for mathematical convenience. Minimizing the norm, or minimizing the square of the norm, leads to the same solution. But from a mathematical point of view, minimizing a squared function is much nicer. In particular, if you can already imagine what's going on, we might want to take the derivative, and then we have 2 times w, essentially, what is written here. And this is what makes it nicer, so in the end, this is why people chose this optimization problem. Here are some first insights we could get by looking at this problem. The first one is that it's a convex problem. Let's go back. So the norm here is convex. We have seen that before in the case of regression. So a squared norm is something convex. The constraints here are linear constraints. The coefficients we are talking about is w and b. So it's not so important whether this is linear in x or y, but it's important in the coefficients that we want to minimize over, and this x and b, and both occur in a linear fashion in this expression. Now, a problem that has a quadratic objective function and linear constraints, this is called a quadratic optimization problem, and that's a particularly nice optimization problem. This is also what I have here on the next slide. There are very efficient solvers that are particularly tuned towards quadratic optimization problem. They're convex, but they have a nice structure, so there exist very nice solvers for this one. One thing you might want to observe is that the solution that you find from this optimization problem is always going to be a hyperplane in canonical representation, which is nice, and it sort of wouldn't make so much sense if it wouldn't be the case, but this is still something that's not obvious, so you might want to prove that. We might put it on an exercise sheet. If we don't, you might want to prove it anyways at home. And here I wrote again that this reason to have the constant 1/2 is sort of for mathematical convenience. And we are often very sloppy with constants. I wrote here sometimes we even drop it later because we don't want to take track of all the constants in the optimization problem. Now, this is all nice, but there's obviously a very big disadvantage, which is that currently we always derive the support vector machine just for the case where the two classes are separable. So if there exists a hyperplane that really separates the two classes. If there doesn't exist such a hyperplane, the thing breaks down because the definition of the margin doesn't really work anymore, because it always assumes that we can separate the data points. And if we cannot, then sort of we need to think about what to do instead. So what we are going to do then is to derive what is called the soft margin support vector machine, which is going to solve this problem. Now, this comes on the next slide. We now want to allow for the case that the hyperplane can make some errors. So there might be some training points which are ambiguous, which might even belong to a wrong class. It might also be that the problem is not separable at all, like in the example where we wanted to classify people as being female or male based on their height of their body. And of course, there is not a unique solution that always predicts the correct thing. So no matter how we would put a classifier here, there would always be some people who are mispredicted. And this is the case we now want to treat. And now in optimization, there is something very common that you try to do, is you say, okay, here's a condition, the hard margin condition, that I can't always satisfy. So what I'm going to do is I allow for not satisfying this condition, but I measure by how far essentially I violate this condition. And then I punish. The more I violate the condition, the more I punish. And I'm trying to prefer solutions where this punishment is small. Now, let's look at it in this particular example. What we now do is we introduce what is called a slack variable, xi I. So for each data point xi, we introduce a slack variable, xi I. And essentially, the slack variable is supposed to measure how far this particular data point sits on the wrong side of the hyperplane, if it does. So what we're going to do is, we look at an optimization problem, the objective function now gets extended. The first part here, this 1/2 norm of w squared, is still the same as we had before. But now we have a second term, which for some funny reason I cannot mark with my mouse pointer, but don't worry. So c over n is just a trade-off constant, we are going to discuss it later. But what is important now is this sum over xi I. So for each data point, this xi I is supposed to be some kind of punishment term, and we sum over all these punishments. And then the sum of all these expressions should be as small as possible. So we have two different ingredients here. We have that the margin is supposed to be small, and the punishments are supposed to be small at the same time. But now how do these punishments work? This is sort of hidden in the constraints now. So previously, if you remember, we had the constraints yi times wxi plus b is supposed to be larger than 1. This was the hard margin constraint. Now we allow that the thing is not larger than 1, it can be something smaller. So the expression here can be smaller than 1 now. Xi I is going to be a positive number, we have that here. So all xi i's, these punishment constants are positive or non-negative. So when, say, xi I is 0.5, then we have here, all of a sudden, we don't have it's larger or equal to 1, but only to 1 minus 0.5, so 0.5. But now, this 0.5, sort of, by which we go beyond the 1, this is going to end up in our punishment term. So this 0.5 here is now in the sum, which I cannot mark with my mouse pointer. And now there's, like, if I have a data point, there are two cases. It could be that it's very easy for this data point to be on the right side of the hyperplane, and then I don't have any punishment term. Then I simply choose xi I is 0, and I'm on the right side of the hyperplane as I would have been before. But now if there's a certain point that would sit on the wrong side of the hyperplane, I'm still allowed to choose that hyperplane, but I incur a punishment that depends on how much this point sits on the wrong side of the hyperplane. So this is sort of a standard approach that is taken very often in optimization. If you cannot satisfy a condition, then introduce these kind of slack variables and try to minimize the violations of this condition. The constant C here that we have in front of this violation term, it's called the C parameter of the support vector machine. It's always called C in the literature. This is a kind of trade-off constant, as we had in rich regression or so, which controls the trade-off between the two parts. There might be different weights. So if we choose a very large C, then it's very important to us that we do not have points on the wrong side of the hyperplane. Because if C is large, then this term here is supposed to become very small. And if C is very small, then sort of we say we don't even care about this punishment. Hopefully the margin is going to be small. And this is called the soft margin support vector machine. Because it now this margin condition has been softened, this is why it's called soft margin SVM. Note that this problem is also a quadratic optimization problem, because the objective function is still a quadratic function. Now maybe consider what are the variables that we have in our optimization problem. We have the original variables W and B, but we now have n more variables. All the slack variables are also variables that we need to optimize. So not only do we now need to find the parameters omega and B, but at the same time also these parameters xi I. And this is still a function that is quadratic in all of these ingredients. So this term is quadratic in omega, this is linear in the xi's, and something that is a sum of linear and quadratic term is still a quadratic function. So the objective function is still a quadratic function, a bit more complex than we had before, but still. And this is still a linear function, it's more or less the same. This is also something that's linear in xi. Now there's a geometric interpretation to these parameters xi I, to these punishment parameters, and I want to show you this interpretation. The first one is, if xi I is 0, then the point is on the correct side of the hyperplane, and it's even going to be outside of the margin. Because what we say is, and we want to have, like in the hard margin case, we want to have all training points outside of the margin on the correct side. If we do not punish, this is exactly the case. Now, what we're going to see on the next slide is, if xi I is in the interval between 0 and 1, then xi I is still going to be on the correct side of the hyperplane, but already has moved into the margin. And if xi I gets larger than 1, then the point is even on the wrong side of the hyperplane. And now maybe let's look at a figure that's easier to see. So here we have a couple of points. The blue circles are one class and the red crosses are the other class. We have a hyperplane here, and the dashed lines indicate the margin. So, for example, this point here, I can't mark it, sorry. This point here sits outside of the margin on the correct side, so it would have xi I equals to 0. There's no punishment at all for this particular point. Now, this point here, which has this arrow pointing towards it, that already sits inside the margin. It is still on the correct side of the hyperplane, but it's inside the margin, and we would like to have the points not inside the margin because we want to have a large margin. So we are going to punish this point. This is some parameter xi I, which is between 0 and 1. And then this point here, this circle, for some reason is on the wrong side of the hyperplane. And this gets punished even more. And it has a xi I that is larger than 1. And the more it's going to be on the wrong side of the hyperplane, the more this xi I is going to grow and the more it's going to be punished. So if this point is somewhere very far outside, beyond the red crosses, the punishment is going to be enormous. And with this intuition, we can also now understand the soft margin SVM in terms of regularized risk minimization. If you maybe forget about the constraints for the moment, just look at the objective function. We have one term which says minimize the margin or maximize the margin in terms of minimizing the norm of W squared. And then we have this term here, which we can now interpret as some kind of risk term or loss function. So what we want to do is we now want to find a loss function such that this sum of xi I is in fact the loss of the classifier for these particular data points. And then the first term here, this is going to turn out to be the regularization term. As you can see, it does not directly depend on individual training points. It's more like a property of this function. And as we used to regularize enriched regression, for example, by the norm of W or this, like depending on in which regression we use the square norm, we might also punish by the L1 norm. And this is sort of a similar spirit, so this would be the regularization term. And let's maybe go towards the place where we can try to prove what is this loss function. And to see this, what we're going to do is we take this linear constraint that we have that involves these xi I parameters. And this can be easily rewritten, you need to be a bit of trickling, by saying xi I is larger or equal than the maximum of either 0 or 1 minus yi omega xi plus b. Okay, so there might be two cases. Either the point is classified correctly, then we don't incur any loss, xi I is 0 and we're happy. And you can see that if a point is classified correctly, then this expression here is larger or equal to 1. Sorry, if a point is classified correctly, this expression is larger or equal to 0. Ah, okay, exactly. We need to... and here we come. What I said was not entirely correct. If a point is classified correctly and is outside of the margin, it doesn't incur any loss. So if this term here, omega x plus b, if the absolute value of this term is larger than 1 and it has the same sign as yi, this means that the training point xi is classified on the correct side and sits outside of the margin. And then this expression here, we have 1 minus something that is at least 1. So we are left with the maximum, which is 0. So the xi I is 0, we don't get any punishment. If we have a point that is on the right side of the hyperplane, but maybe it's inside the margin, we start incurring a loss. And essentially, this number here this whole number here, measures how far we are inside the margin. If we sit right on the margin, this term yi omega xi plus b is exactly 1, so we don't have any loss. But as soon as we start moving in the margin, we have a loss that increases linearly, according to how far we are from the margin. And if a point now sits on the wrong side of the hyperplane, it increases even further. So then this expression here becomes something that is even negative, and we have minus something negative, so it's positive, so this gets even a larger number. And now we can define, essentially we can define a loss function by this expression. What we now do is we simply define a loss for input data x and y and the predicted value f of x, and the loss is defined exactly as the expression we had before, the maximum over 0 and 1 minus y f of xi. And if you plot this loss, it looks exactly like this one here. So on the x-axis, we have again, as we have seen it previously, yi times f of x. So we have, again, if y times f of x is positive, then we classified the point on the correct side. If it's negative, it's misclassified. But we can see now the loss already, not only the loss starts to count if we're on the wrong side of the hyperplane, but it already starts to count if this expression gets smaller than one. These are the points for which we sit inside the hyperplane, but on the correct side of the margin. And then once we move beyond the zero line here, we're on the wrong side of the margin of the hyperplane, and the loss increases linearly by depending on how far we are away from this hyperplane. I also want to show this loss function in the context of other loss functions, and we have seen this plot already before. Now let's see the hinge loss is this one here. As you can see, it increases linearly if we go to the wrong side. And this is essentially very close to what the logistic loss does. The logistic loss also more or less increases linearly. Whereas many of the other losses, like exponential loss or squared loss or so, they increase in a much, much more faster way when we go to the wrong side of the hyperplane. And it is sort of a robustness kind of feature of SVMs and also logistic regression, that the loss only increases linearly. Because somehow if you have a point that by all means you cannot classify correctly, and for example you have an outlier data point and it sits far away from everything else, if the loss grows quadratically with the distance of this point to your classification or to the other points, then essentially this point is going to dominate everything. And this you don't want. So often in robust statistics what we do is we try to only punish in a linear fashion. And this is what happens in the hinge loss here. And as in the case of the logistic loss as well, we still have punishment if we're on the correct side of the hyperplane, but only as long as we are inside the margin. And as soon as we're outside of the margin, we do not have any particular loss anymore, so then we incur zero loss. Whereas the logistic loss, for example, it's this red line here, it still incurs any loss, it's a loss, the loss goes to zero, and at some point gets negligible. You can sort of ignore it. Whereas for the support vector machine, we stop at some point to encounter any loss, as soon as we are essentially on the right side of the margin and on the right side of the hyperplane. Okay, here I summarize the properties of this loss function, but I think I mentioned all of them already. So the loss function punishes points even if they're still on the correct side of the hyperplane, but inside the margin. And it increases linearly, not quadratically or in any other way, once we go on the wrong side of the hyperplane. So, now we have this loss function, and now we can in fact interpret the soft margin SVM in a standard regularization kind of framework. Our problem now looks as follows. I simply rewrite, it's exactly the same kind of function we had before, it's just arranged in a different way. Because in empirical risk minimization, or in regularized risk minimization, the standard form is minimize regularized risk plus regularization term, no, sorry, minimize empirical risk plus regularization term. So I now change the order to have the same kind of thing. So here is minimize the empirical risk with respect to the hinge loss plus the regularization term, as I said before. Essentially what we have here is a squared norm regularizer. And the only difference, but that's sort of for historic reasons, between this expression and the one we had, for example, in rich regression, is that the trade-off constant for support vector machines is in front of the risk and not in front of the regularizer. This doesn't really matter. You can observe sort of the same kind of behavior. You can now think about what happens if C is small and what happens if C gets large. And it's sort of inverse to what would happen if we would have a constant here, lambda, and this lambda is going to be small and large. You can maybe try to figure it out yourself. And it's simply a convention. This is because the first couple of papers for support vector machines started to call this constant C and put it in front of this risk term. And it simply stayed this way in the literature. Okay, I already mentioned it, but you might want to take it as an exercise. If you drive C very large, what is going to happen? And if you drive C very small, what is going to happen? What are sort of these boundary cases of SVMs? In which ones do we underfit? In which ones do we overfit? Which one controls variance and bias term and all these kind of considerations? So here's our first summary. We have seen the linear SVM. And what we have seen is the linear SVM tries to maximize the margin between two classes. In the hard margin case, we only consider solutions without any training errors, but the soft margin SVM can look at these training errors and has sort of a trade-off between the margin between the errors of your solution and the margin. In both cases, both for hard and soft SVM, you end up with a quadratic optimization problem. It's convex, it's very nice, there exist specific solvers to solve that. And we have this interpretation in terms of regularized risk minimization with the hinge loss function. So I don't know whether I mentioned the name of this loss function, it's called the hinge loss. So hinge, for the ones in German, hinge is something like Türangel or so, Gelenk. So a hinge is like a door that opens or closes or so, and this is sort of the hinge loss. It comes from this kind of behavior, it's like a hinge.